It's Thursday, September 29th, and you're listening to the Geek News Central Podcast, show number 709, sponsored by GoDaddy.com. Geek News Central is a proud member of the Tech Podcast Network. If it's tech, it's here. Everyone, I've got a great show lined up for you tonight. Lots to talk about. And of course, Geek News Central is sponsored in part by GoToMeeting. With HD Faces, the world's best web conferencing solution, get your free trial at GoToMeeting.com. Click the Try It Free button and use the promo code PODCAST. You know what comes next. Strap in. Here it comes.
All right, people, I need a go-no-go for the Geek News Central podcast. Digital archive recorders.
We're go fly.
Microphone.
We're go fly.
Video feed.
Go.
Web browser.
Go.
RSS data stream aggregator.
Go fly.
Interflux Toddism suppressor.
All right, I'm confused.
Host readiness check.
Welcome to the show. Welcome to the show.
The Geek News Central podcast is a proud member of the Tech Podcast Network. If it's tech, it's here. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are ready to go. Cue Todd in...
Five.
Button, who's got the button?
Four.
There is no cause for alarm.
Three.
Everybody hold on to something.
Two.
Just press the button.
One.
It's showtime.
Aloha and welcome to the Geek News Central podcast, coming to you as live as it can be from the beautiful state of Hawaii via the Geek News Central studio overlooking Greater Honolulu. Hey everyone, welcome to the show. Of course, my name is Todd Cochran, and I want to encourage you to get over to geeknewscentral.com, check out all our great content. Of course, check out our archive podcasts available via the podcast link, and also some good news on the Robot Underpants show. We'll talk about that here in a few moments. But make sure you get over to the website, and really the best thing to do when you get over there is really get subscribed to all of the shows. And you'll find in the second column of the website, you'll find a place to subscribe to the audio or video podcast. You can sign up for the Saturday Morning Tech Show, The Gadget Professor, Robot Underpants, or The Chrome Show, which I think we're going to be able to come back online with this weekend. So we'll talk about that here in a few moments. But of course, you can do it via iTunes, Zune Marketplace, your favorite RSS feed, whatever it may be. Go ahead and get subscribed, and of course, sign up for the newsletter when you're over at the website as well. The newsletter contains everything that I'm going to talk about during the show. I send that out immediately following the show. It has all the links to all the content, and it's a great way for you to stay abreast of basically when the show has been released. And number two, gives you all the links to all the content, any type of notices as well. Of course, we want to give a warm welcome to all of the Ohana, all of you that are longtime listeners of the show, those are your family members. Thank you for being here and thanks for staying subscribed. We want to welcome listeners from around the world for being listening and watching the show. And of course, you can watch us on the Tech Podcast channel on the Roku, Boxy, Samsung Smart TV, Looky TV, and a variety of other devices. Of course, you can reach me on Twitter at Geek News, or you can email the show at geeknews@gmail.com. Of course, you can always call the voicemail hotline at 619-342-7365. And that's something I didn't do tonight. I didn't go over and check and see if we had any calls come in. We'll get that set up, and we'll play that near the end of the show. Let me turn down a volume here, and that way you guys aren't getting the computer background noise. And of course, those of you watching on the stream right now, we're at live.geeknewscentral.com, and of course, we're up live simulcasting on Ustream as well. Well, of course, we're here at the end of the month. I want to give a very warm thank you to all of you that supported our sponsors this past month. Of course, I want to thank Citrix, GoToMeeting for being here, for a sponsor for the entire month, and of course, GoDaddy.com. You guys really understand that without GoDaddy, without Citrix, this show would not be able to do what we do. We'd not be able to, one, support some of the bandwidth costs, be able to, and everything else that goes along with putting on the show, plus paying my salary and feeding my family and keeping the house payments made and everything else. So we want to thank the sponsors for being here and supporting the show. And really, we would not be able to cash that paycheck without the large audience that you are. And thank you for being here and, of course, staying subscribed and sharing the show with the people that you know. And really, it's what it's all about. And you can help the show at any time by telling your friends, family members, coworkers, hey, have you checked Todd out over at Geek News Central? He puts on a great show twice a week. Definitely checking the show out. And we'd appreciate anyone that you send over. Of course, if you're new following the show for the very first time and you are just followed me or circled me on Google+, You know, I have to give a shout out to Robert Scoble. He added me, basically, he shared one of his circles of basically tech people that he follows, and I was in that list, and I nearly doubled overnight the number of people that were following me on Google Plus. So if you're here from Google Plus, thanks for circling me, and I hope that I won't let you down in the great content they put up and make available to you. So I want to, of course, encourage you all to get subscribed to the show as well. Well, of course, as always, if you want to support the show as well, you can go over to cafepress.com. And let me actually put this up on the big screen here. cafepress.com/Ohana Store. And you can pick out pick up great wear for the show, basically T-shirts, sweatshirts, and starting to get cool in some areas, mugs, hats, pads, you name it. We've got it available for you there at cafepress.com/Ohana Store. And I want to thank Sam for being our navigator over there and managing everything. And thanks, Sam, for running the Ohana Store at, again, cafepress.com/Ohana. So while I was talking about the sponsors real quick, let me go ahead and just share with you guys a new special that I've got going on this month. I actually put a post up on it on Geek News Central. You should have seen it yesterday. And this is a new product I've been introduced to. It's called the Online File Folder. And really what this is cloud storage. It's not much different than what you would find at S3 or a variety of other places, or even maybe some of you picked up a Carbonite account when Carbonite was a sponsor here. But this is kind of a pretty cool new way to store online at a very, very low price. So if you want a better way to back up, store, and share your files, over the next 2 weeks, the offer here from GoDaddy in making online file folders available is you can get their deluxe plan at $1.99 a month. So the normal economy plan runs the normal economy plan runs $1.99. The deluxe plan runs $2.49. So by doing a 12-month order, you'll get the price at $1.99 per month. That's going to give you 100 gigs of storage space, unlimited sharing. You can do backups manually or automatic. You can even add additional storage as well. If you want to add more to the account, you can. So there's the ability to do that. So they've got some cool stuff with this. You can sync with get files available, auto synchronization. It's PC and Mac compatible. You can do multiple access points with your computer, with a website, FTP, and also an iPhone app as well. And this is a brand new product. I was not aware of this at all from the folks at GoDaddy. And matter of fact, you know, this when they sent this over, I was like, wow, you guys have got this? And I really didn't know what they had, you know, for availability on this. So when they sent the email to me 2 days ago, I immediately signed up for it and have been using it, and it is really a great product. I can share these file information or the actual login information with friends and coworkers. I can make some stuff private, some stuff public. Start any file type. I can back up files securely as well. So definitely check it out and use the promo code. Let's see here. It's GeekFile, I believe, is what the actual promo code is. Yeah, Geek, GeekFile. Is the promo code for this. Again, this is only going to be good through October 15th, so you've got a couple weeks to jump on this. Now, of course, don't forget you can go over to geeknewscentral.com/GoDaddy, and you can find all my promo codes there for every occasion, whether it be an SSL certificate, whether you're doing a hosting account by using my promo code Todd20, whether renewing a .com by using the ComSale promo code. If you want to save $20 on an order of $70 or $75 or more, you can use the promo code Aloha. So in geeknewscentral.com/GoDaddy for all the codes. And we want to thank GoDaddy for being a longtime sponsor here at Geek News Central. Hey, one thing, I did get a couple of messages, one from my mom specifically, and another a longtime listener of the show, saying that they were having trouble downloading the audio file of the podcast from show number 708. I did a test tonight and everything is coming through like it should. I only get a couple of complaints. So if you had issues, please tell me which internet service provider you're with. what part of the country you're in, because if the CDN is dropping, because what happens is when I upload the file, it's basically the media files hosted by Raw Voice hosting or Blueberry hosting, and then it gets shoved up to the CDN, and the CDN then disperses the file to multiple locations, and that is where you basically grab the file from the location closest to you. And if we got a corrupted file where it didn't get completely transferred into one of the CDN nodes, I'll have to track that down. I'm going to ask Angelo to do a flush in the morning. We got a way where we can flush the system and basically re-queue it. But it's something like this we really want to stay abreast of, and we'll go back to the CDN and say, hey, there's a problem with the node somewhere where the file went, and people were having trouble downloading it. So thanks for the heads up on that, though. We definitely appreciate it, and hope that wasn't too many of you. Just to also let you know, jury duty is finished. Matter of fact, at 4 p.m. Hawaiian Standard Time today, the jury was finally seated in the trial that I was luckily not picked for. I can tell you a little more now what was going on. They had 151 of us in the jury pool, and we started last week Tuesday. And from there, it's went to full circle. And when we got done today, there was only 17 of us left in the pool that had not been picked. And what it was, and because I'm not on the case no more and I have to worry about disclosure, it was a attempted murder in the second degree case with three defendants, and each of them had their own lawyers. So basically what happened was when we finally got to the point where they drew the names for the first initial 12 on the jury pool, then the lawyers each had, the prosecution had 18 deferrals and each lawyer had six each. And so they would, you know, they would defer somebody, they'd have to see them and go through the questioning on, you know, are you going to be a good juror? And all these questions they ask them 10, 15 minutes later, they'd either keep them or toss them. And generally they were picked, they were, you know, I think chair number eight was replaced 15 times. But I think the they use almost every deferral up to the last couple where they finally decided, okay, we've got the jury that we want. And I just got lucky. I didn't get pulled. But we were all kind of looking at each other at the end. And I was like, thank gosh, this is over. But if you're a lawyer, oh, man, you are definitely banking some dollars. Because the number of billable hours over just the jury selection alone was amazing. Now, I think our defendants had public defenders, and I know that usually public defenders don't make a lot of money, but it was quite the process, and I'm glad that I'm done and out, and hopefully not subject to recall for another case for a while. But anyway, that's behind me, and that was my experience with jury duty, and a full, what was it, 9-10 days of, well, it felt like that because you had the weekend there, but from Tuesday to a week ago, Tuesday to today, so I guess 7 trial days, and can you imagine just take that long to just pick a jury? Crazy stuff. But anyway, that's gone and over with. Hey, podcast award nominations close tomorrow, so they wrap up tomorrow evening, so if you haven't nominated your shows, make sure you get over there and do that right away. And we will let you know here in another week or so about what the slate of shows that are going to be basically up for voting here. We'll probably start voting around the 15th of October. Depends on how everything goes on the review. And those of you that already had submitted requests to be reviewers, we want to thank you. And we'll be sending you emails out on how to get started on that. Saturday Morning Tech Show, it will be on for this Saturday. It will be a 90-minute show, and then I have to roll out of here quickly because my daughter has a cross-country meet. But we will be doing Saturday Morning Tech at 9 a.m. Pacific, 12 a.m. Eastern if you want to join in. And a new edition of The Gadget Professor should be on the street today, so look out for that. And, of course, Langley sent me an email. He said, hey, Todd, you know, the biggest problem I had with doing Robot Underpants was the video. Can I do an audio version? I had said, yes, let's go ahead and continue if you can do an audio version. So I haven't heard back from Langley, but I think Robot Underpants will continue as an audio version. If he decides he doesn't want to continue to do it, we will definitely fill that show with another producer and continue to move forward with it. Okay, let me go ahead here and take care of one last piece of business, then we'll get everyone into the tech content. And I have a stack of it today, so I don't want to waste too much of your time through the beginning here. But You guys know I've really been excited about GoToMeeting with HD Faces. You know, it's the way I meet online with colleagues. And, you know, they've just added the new high-definition video conferencing to GoToMeeting. And now you can collaborate with anyone around the world face-to-face. And this is just absolutely awesome, the way this is set up and the way it works. You're really able to, with just, you know, a click of the button, you're able to see the other people on your meeting, and they can see you, and they can see your screen as well. So this just works absolutely fantastic. And it'll make your meetings very personal, engaging, effective, and it's very effective. It's very easy to use, and really all you need is an internet connection, a webcam. So here's what I want. As a listener of this show, I want you to try GoToMeeting with HD Faces. I'm promising you, it's going to change the way you work. As a listener of this show, you can get a free 30-day trial. All you got to do is visit GoToMeeting.com. Again, visit GoToMeeting.com, click the Try It Free button, and use the promo code PODCAST. Be sure to use the promo code PODCAST to get your free trial. And we want to thank Citrix GoToMeeting for being a sponsor here at Geek News Central. All right, let me go ahead and open up the stack of stuff I have for you tonight, which is a lot. And let me see here. What have we got? Let me go back to the first article. We already talked about that. And I don't know how that ended up there. Let's take him all the way down. You guys, you know, I'm a pretty big, let me show you this first before we get too hot and heavy and serious. I'm really a chair aficionado. And yes, I said that correctly. A chair aficionado. I like nice, comfortable chairs. And I have found one that I want to order. And it was reviewed today on Wired. You guys know I've got this real cool chair here. It's got a mesh back. It's a great chair. I think I paid around $500 for it when I got it. I've had it here in the studio since I think I had it when we were still at Fort Island. But I spent so much time at my desk. I really need a great chair. But this is a new one. And let me show this to you. This is a chair by Knoll, K-N-O-L-L. And they've done a lot of work on this, and it really kind of looks a lot like the chair I have now, except they've added all kinds of cool features where the pad kind of moves with you, and the chair kind of does more of a, it bends a little bit to your will. And what they did is they did this study, and they were able to find out that people are really moving a lot during the day. They're not just sitting, so they're bending, they're twisting, they're stretching. And they're saying that this chair is so nice that it'll almost make you feel weightless. And now the price on this, they've got two prices on this, is what scares me. One of the prices says $592. Another one says $1,195. Now, if it's $1,195, I will not be picking it up. I will not be buying a $1,200 chair. As much as I would like to update and maybe get a new chair, this one definitely is a little bit outside of the price range. But if it's, you know, and you're going to say, okay, what's the difference between $1,200, Todd, and $600? Well, it's a lot. And but I'm always looking for to make improvements here, you know. And it basically is about comfort and not being tired at the end of the day. And while this chair is good, you know, I think it's time to potentially look at a new chair. And if you sit in a chair a lot at your office or your workplace, make sure your boss buys you a good chair. Really, if he doesn't, you'll buy your own and take it to work and chain it to your desk. Make sure someone doesn't steal it. All right. On the last show, I really went heavily into Facebook, and you know, I think it's been all over the news. People have been, well, on the same bandwagon as I. And over the past two or three days, there's been a lot of announcements made, maybe a potential investigation by the Federal Trade Commission and some other things. But what happened in Europe, and I hear a dog barking in. I got a neighbor that's on vacation, and their little dog, his name is Willow. And he's missing his mom and dad. They're they're out And Willow's looking for him. But anyway, I can hear him barking in the background. But in Europe, data privacy rules have allowed folks to successfully request and receive a detailed list of all the data that Facebook has kept about them. Now, this should make all of you really even consider even more what you're putting on Facebook. Now, the pages have been redacted. A lot of stuff has been blacked out because there was just so much information in here. But Facebook sent one particular user 880 pages. Yes, 880 pages of information about a specific Facebook user. And it shows everything, all the details about when you connected, who you chatted with, chat logs, anytime you posted anything on anybody's wall, when you logged in, what IP you logged in from, how long you were on, conversations that you had, people that you friended, unfriended, and just on and on and on and on. And they got it broke down here very specifically about how you accessed and where and when and what dates. And they, it looks to me like they keep a permanent record of everything that you've done on Facebook. Everything. Simply, you know, and here's the thing that it makes me go, a little bit. Imagine, okay, so let's just talk about this being, number one, being an issue. Number two, what could be done with this data? So someone actually, let's say you're going through a divorce and all of a sudden they subpoena these records. They're going to be able to tell who you talked to, when you talked to them, where you talked to them, what you talked about, what the discussion was, or you talked to a friend and confided in them. Very scary stuff. And this article is over on TechDirt. So I'll let you guys go over there and take a look yourself at the complete article. They've got the document that was submitted to them listed right on the website. You can see all 880 pages yourself and get an idea what kind of information they have. But it really looks like Facebook is keeping just about everything on you. So don't be surprised, all right? So, you know, this thing goes deeper and deeper. You know, it's not, and remember, they're keeping logs on you. Now, of course, privacy advocates are upset and they want the FTC to look at them. But news organizations are already starting to kind of withdraw a little bit because some apps out there, if you have a Washington Post social reader, if you go and you have that specific iPhone app loaded, and you basically use the Washington Post social reader, it's going to call home to Facebook and tell Facebook which pages you're reading. The Guardian has one as well. And so, you know, the Wall Street Journal doesn't have this that calls home to mama, but a lot of newspaper sites do. And it's, and this one is specifically through an app. But how long before they start pushing articles or pushing what you're reading back to Facebook when you're just on someone's page? Now, Spotify did relent, and users now are going to be able to get a private listing mode, but you still have to log in to Facebook. So in other words, they're going to allow you to not have it send updates to Facebook every time you play a track, but you're still going to have to log in to Facebook. And those of you that are watching the show, this is not a brew. This is a iced tea. Almost wish it would be a brew, but it's not, okay? So, you know, that's one thing. Spotify knew they were in trouble, and they basically backed off. But you still have to have a Facebook account to log in. Now, probably the biggest news, of course, this week was the announcement of the new Kindles. And I say Kindles with an S because there are multiple Kindles that are being basically released. And the new lineup consists of 6 different models that basically are going to fit almost anyone's budget, starting at $79 for the new Kindle. This base model has the same 6-inch e-ink display. The new ones do not have a keyboard, And it's going to make it lighter and smaller. It has Wi-Fi only, no 3G option. The next models are the Kindle Touch and the Kindle Touch 3G. Now, I'm going to recommend if you're going to stick with the e-ink ones that you get the Kindle Touch 3G. And these are the same as the basic Kindle only. They have the multi-touch e-ink display. And they're going to cost $99 for the Wi-Fi version and $149 for the 3G version. They're going to be available on November 21st. Now, to top that off, they're going to have the new one, of course. The new one is the $199 Kindle Fire. It's very much like the Nook color. This has a backlit multi-touch screen and runs a very skinned version of Android. You're still going to be able to download apps from the Amazon App Store. And there's no word on when you're going to be able to use this, but they are going to be available on November 15th. And it's going to be priced at $199. Now, this is the first version that they're coming out with. And this is a little bit of an underpowered device. But for two bills, who cares? For $200. This is potentially, and these are Wi-Fi only, so be aware of that. But if you want, you know, if you can afford it, this might be a great stocking stuffer. At $200, my wife is like, we're talking about it, and she says, boy, she says, can we afford to get three? And she wants to at least get one or two so that we can have, give them to the kids to use. And, you know, I think in a couple of years, we're going to be able to get these free, you know, but right now, you know, this $200 price point's pretty doggone good if you really think about it compared to everything else. Now, it's not the iPad. It's probably not going to have the power of the iPad. It's probably going to be a little slower, but at $200, you're going to have access to the entire Amazon App Store. You're going to be able to share your Amazon account. So I think you're going to be able to have, I think you have five devices connected to your Amazon account, so you can share books across five devices. And this is I think, a pretty big deal. And I think that Amazon's going to do very well. And it's going to prime the pump definitely for Amazon Video, because you now, if you want to, and here's the kicker, though. Remember, these are Wi-Fi only devices. The Amazon Kindle Fire is only going to be Wi-Fi. It's not going to be 3G. So this isn't going to be the device that you're going to want to download stuff to it and then travel. You're not going to want to go watching videos on this in a hotel. But if you're at home, if you have the $79 a year Amazon Prime service and tied in with the video service, could be a winner here. And so we'll see what happens with this. And with their... but the subscription video service from Amazon priced, their streaming service priced below $7.99, which currently the Netflix subscribers pay, you know, because you're paying for a year at $79. And I think they could have a winner here. So how many are you going to run out and pick up one of these Kindles? Now, there's some serious competition out there. And let's see if I can show you this from PC World. And this actually was, I found this original article over on technologizer.com. How come I can't say that? Anyway, here's the breakdown. And if you think about it, the Amazon Kindle Fire is going to be $199. The Nook Color is $249. The Research in Motion Playbook is $353. The Lenovo ID, and the IdeaPad A1 is $250. Doesn't have a date yet on this. The Hikona Tab A100 is available at $330. The iPad 2 at $499. But you know, all these other devices except for the Playbook, which is by RIM, is running on Android. So you got Android 2.2, some are running 2.3, 3.2. But KNX is running on RIM. Of course, you've got iOS on the iPad too. But anyway, what you're going to end up here with is you've got lots of selections. This is a great chart to really kind of make a decision point on which way you want to go. I have this link up in the show notes, and it breaks it down by Wi-Fi, 3G, OS, thickness, weight, display size, resolution, processor, RAM, storage, and it just goes through everything. So talks about cameras, back cameras, Bluetooth, HDMI, USB. So you just remember, though, on this Kindle Fire, that is a drawback. No camera, no Bluetooth, no HDMI. It does have USB, does not have a GPS. So, you know, and it also is 1,024 by 600, which is close to the iPad. It is 7 inches. It's pretty comparable to all the other devices out there except for the iPad, which is 9.7. So, you know, in the weight, you know, it kind of doesn't really matter. They're all of them are pretty light. But will this be your replacement? Will this be the replace your iPad? I don't think so. But I think it will give you some options out there as you're considering different devices you may want to buy. And I'll definitely get at least one. For nothing else, to see how our Blueberry app from the Amazon App Store works on the tablet. And don't forget about that. For those of you that are listening, if you have an Android device, get the Blueberry podcasting app. It's free, and that'll get you access. Oh, what did I do? I just dropped a power strip off a computer. You will have a basically access to all the shows at blueberry.com, all the managed programming over there. All right, over in digitaltrends.com, they're saying, for those of you that are Xbox users, they're saying the Xbox dashboard update is happening on November 15th. And there's going to be some big things happening. And I'm sure Xbox is planning to roll out a whole bunch of stuff here, of course, for the holidays. And the folks at Digital Trends has a good write-up on that. But the new dashboard is coming. But along with that, Xbox has reportedly added video from Comcast, Verizon, HBO Go, and others to Xbox Live as well. So here's the thing about Xbox Live. The content that you're going to see on there, you are probably going to have to either pay a subscription or there's going to be some sort of monetization behind it. You know, I've talked with Rob, and Rob's on our Saturday morning tech show. We've talked a lot about, you know, what's coming. And, of course, Rob can't say too much, but I can infer as much as I can. But you can almost be guaranteed what is ever going to be on the Xbox is going to have some sort of subscription model. There's got to be a way for Microsoft to make money on that, you know, and please understand that's probably why podcast stuff probably won't be on there to begin with. But we look forward to the date where we can bring new media like this directly onto the Xbox. And believe me, I'll be working very hard to make sure that happens. But you're still going to be able to get access to video from Comcast, Verizon, HBO Go, and so forth. This also brings up a discussion point that's been kind of breaking news here over the last couple of days, is that cable companies are talking about doing a proposed a la carte plans. And, you know, I'm thinking, oh man, thank gosh, we're finally going to have a la carte. And of course, we still got the cable cut here. And I'm not winning the battle on that one, folks. So you guys know I don't watch much sports. I do a little NASCAR once in a while. That's about it. But apparently, here's the deal. And this is going to really upset a lot of you. Now, with the talk earlier this week of the cable companies proposing a la carte, I think we all got pretty excited. But what they're really trying to do is the motive behind this is that they want to transform stuff that you're paying for now in your basic cable package, or maybe the first level or the first level up from your basic package. They want to make channels such as ESPN. They're going to make them similar to HBO, so that if you want ESPN and their five or six channels, you're going to have to pay $14.99 a month for it. And they're going to take other of those channels that you watch a lot, and they're going to package those into premium. So maybe your base price for your cable is not going to change, but they're going to remove stuff from the lineup and make those premium offerings. Now, you may get a few more channels with ESPN and some other stuff, but they're feeling that most channels are going to be still packaged as a bundle, but they're going to be breaking out all these different pieces. And these TV broadcast deals the cable companies are having to pay for, basically they're forcing the cable providers are having to shell more money to get the content. But, you know, they've been passing that price right over to us, and our cable bills have been going up and not down. But niche special interest channels are going to probably go away versus staying on, because they'll be able to, because now when they buy ESPN, they have to buy 25 other channels to go along with it. So some of those junk channels that probably most of us don't care about will maybe just get dropped. So that's kind of what they're saying their plan might be. So this a la carte thing may be a la carte cable style. You know, we've talked a lot about TV's future and the battle for input number one. I've talked about this a lot on this show. The folks over at New TV at GigaOM have got a great article about this. And, you know, I think that a lot of people are starting to wake up that input number one on your television is really where the money's to be made, and what the battle's over right now. So I have the link up, you guys. I'm not going to go into this full article. You guys have heard me talk about this a number of times already about the battle for input number one. But really, I think what Xbox is trying to do, and so is Google TV, they're trying to battle for input number one. But, you know, what it really boils down to is why we've talked about Apple actually coming out with its own Apple TV, is they don't have to battle for input number one. And that's why Samsung and their smart TV packages is important and very, it's where they don't have to, because it's their internet IPTV offerings built right into the television. It's just right on the remote control. So effectively they're on input number one. And I think ultimately that is where it has to be, because, you know, the average person doesn't want to have to change inputs front to input two. My mom, if she switches her TV from her satellite dish to her DVR and she goes one step too far, she's lost and she has to call me to figure out how to get back to her cable TV. She doesn't know how to change the inputs, or she has to muddle through and she cusses at the thing and, you know, pushes the button a certain number of times one way. And, you know, it's, for some people, it's really difficult. So, and most people don't want to mess with it. Most people don't have all six or seven of their inputs on their television filled up like I do, or maybe the rest of you do. But we'll see where this goes. Hey, you know the ACTA? That's a treaty, right? Well, they're not really calling it a treaty, but Japan is announcing a signing ceremony this Saturday, and the United States. See, who else is going to sign this? The EU and Mexico are not going to sign the ACTA agreement, but apparently the administration is going to go ahead and move forward and allow the United States, I guess, is going to sign the ACTA this weekend. I guess they decide they don't have to go to Congress to get approval for this. So Australia, Canada, New Zealand, Korea, Morocco, Singapore are making the moves to sign this weekend. And it's a pretty bold move by the administration, considering the evidence that signing the ACTA without Senate approval is unconstitutional. I guess they're just going to go ahead and sign it and then let someone say it's unconstitutional and go back and fight the president over this. But, you know, I guess actually expecting the president to follow the Constitution is only important when you're not in office. We all should be worried. It doesn't matter who's in office. Something like this should have congressional, you know, it should be ratified. The European Union is going to go back, and they're putting it through their process because they don't feel they can sign it without putting it through their commission. So we'll see. We'll see what happens with this. But the United States, I guess, is going to sign this weekend. Has anybody even read this thing, or are we just going to get get this rammed down our throats? I guess it's just going to be rammed down our throats. All right. You know, and I, you know, you guys know, I know there's a lot of you that, I don't want to get political on the show, and I tend to do that from time to time, but please understand, I'm going to take anyone to task, either party, for things that I see are not good for us on a tech side. I'm not going to hold back. It'll be, you know, if there's a Republican out there that's doing something that needs to be called out, and if you guys see something and it's not right, please tell me if you see something in legislation that's going through. Doesn't matter. We need to, as geeks and people that are thought leaders on this, we really need to be aware of what the administration is doing and call our prospective congresspeople and tell them what we think and, you know, speak out whether you feel it's right to do so or not. But I think that, you know, if this was the prior president that was doing this, I have no doubt in my mind that I'd be saying, what is he doing? And why is he doing this without congressional approval? So don't take it the wrong way. As I've said before, I'm an equal opportunity basher. And I'll give credit when credit is due as well. So, it's just kind of shocking. It really is. Hey, let's talk about these protests that are going on in the Wall Street Journal, specifically about the New York City Police Department and what it's what's happened over the past week and a half or so. You guys know that they've had these Occupy Wall Street demonstrations going on. But what they've been saying here recently, of course, is there's been a few incidences where people have pepper sprayed and arrested. But there have now been a number of reporters that have been arrested who have been taking video outside of the protest. So they've, in other words, they're not within the protest crowd. They're videoing into the protest crowd. And the actual, some reporters have gotten arrested. Reporter John Farley, working for WNET Metro Focus, which is part of the New York PBS station, got arrested, even though he was out of his, not basically in the, not in and amongst those that were protesting. He got charged with disorderly conduct. He identified himself as a reporter. There was even some people that came out with their webcams from stores that were just in the area and were doing some pictures and got arrested as well. One lady said, "Hey, I was looking at some magazines at the Barnes and Noble on Union Square." She walked outside, snapped a picture, and the police arrested her for taking a picture. I guess there was a police officer in the picture. So we just have to continue to make sure that these kind of stories stay alive. And we don't know the full circumstances behind this stuff, but we need to make sure that we're able to regain our rights of being able to protest, and number two, being able to film stuff and not be arrested for doing so. And moving on here, over at Forbes.com, this should make all of you go, A private document shows how phone companies treat privacy data. A document obtained by the ACLU shows, and I'm reading directly from the Forbes article, shows for the first time how the four largest cell phone companies in the United States treat data about their subscribers' calls, text messages, web surfing, and approximate locations. The one-page document from the Justice Department's Cyber Crime Division shows, for instance, that Verizon Wireless keeps for a year information about which cell tower subscribers' phone connect to. That data can be used to figure out where the phone has been down to the level of a neighborhood. AT&T keeps the same data continuously since 2008. The sheet is a guide for law enforcement, which can request information from the carriers through legal channels. And here's another thing that they called out. They said that a few data points from the sheet were known outside, but here's a few more. T-Mobile USA says it doesn't keep any information on web browsing activity. Verizon, on the other hand, keeps some information for up to a year that can be used to ascertain if a particular phone visited a particular website. Sprint Nextel keeps the text content of text messages for 3 months. Verizon keeps it for 3 to 5 days. None of the other carriers keep text at all, but they keep records of who texted whom for more than a year. Goes on to say the document says AT&T keeps for 5 to 7 years a record of who texts whom and when, but not the content of the message. Virgin Mobile only keeps that data for 2 to 3 months. The carriers don't have recordings of calls. They keep information about calls that are made and received for at least a year. Sprint spokesperson said he couldn't comment on the specific figures in the sheet. Normally said a subpoena, court order, or customer consent form from a recognized law enforcement agency is necessary for the carrier to hand out the data. However, Sprint also responds to emergency requests, as in missing person cases, if the police can document their need. So we know that there's a bill in Congress that's forcing wired internet service providers to keep records of network addresses assigned to each subscriber for 18 months, which is being pushed through. So that just goes to tell you, if you're texting someone, you're visiting a website, you're calling someone, they're keeping that information on file. AT&T has it for as long as 7 years. So you get that digital footprint out there. It continues to grow and get bigger, right? You don't have to worry. They know everything about us. Everything. So, Right Haven. Right Haven's lost another one. Senior U.S. District Judge John L. Rain in Denver granted summary judgment for Right Haven lawsuit defendant Leland Wolf and the IT Makes Sense blog against Right Haven. In light of the need to discourage the abuse of the statutory remedies for copyright infringement, I exercise my discretion under the Copyright Act and order that Right Haven shall reimburse Mr. Wolf's full cost defending this action, including reasonable attorney fees. And they want $25,000 from Right Haven this time. So this is, Right Haven keeps getting whacked. Four federal judges in Las Vegas have dismissed 7 Right Haven lawsuits. Right Haven says that it has corrected its standing problem with the Review Journal lawsuits with a new lawsuit. So they continue to file stuff. But the judges are having none of it. So we'll see where this goes. They think this is another huge whack on Right Haven. And this article just goes on and on and on. And this is over at VegasINC.com. I'll have the link up in the show notes. It's only a matter of time before these guys are gone. Hey, one thing on my TriCaster now that we've got this new feature. And actually, I was going to have my iPad in here to do it. But I didn't grab it quick enough. Before I started the show, I want to show you guys, though, a video from SpaceX. It's a little long, so I'm only going to show you the first segment. But they've done a digital rendering of what they feel is going to be how they're going to recycle their lift capacity. And I think this is a pretty cool stuff. Now, I don't know about the song. I'm hoping the song is not copyright because this will pop when I put this up on YouTube. But let me play just a little bit of this video for you. And those of you that I guess I'll describe it. I'll talk over it. So those of you that are listening will know what I'm talking about here. So let me go ahead and play this. So it's showing a rocket on the pad taking off. And, of course, this animation is the SpaceX rocket heads up. It's got a capsule on top. And it shows it getting into space. And then the main stage that got him into orbit breaks away. And the second stage takes over. So what happens then is that the first stage actually has thrusters on it. And it turns itself around. And then does a deorbit burn. And I don't know if they deorbit burn all the way down or not. But they show it heading back towards the launch area. And then powers down and lands on a flat pad. Now, I think that this is a huge, huge challenge. The folks at SpaceX to make this happen. And part of this video shows the second stage basically doing the same thing. The second stage gets the spacecraft to a higher altitude, and then it actually, when it re-enters, it has a heat shield on it that does the first part of the re-entry, and then it on its way in, it flips over and does another powered descent into a landing pad. And finally, for the actual returning crew that's come back from the International Space Station or from a mission, what they do with that is instead of, and they don't show no parachutes on this thing, which is kind of scary in itself, but a typical type of reentry, kind of an Apollo type of reentry. And then at the very last minute, they go ahead and again, another power burn to slow the spacecraft down, and they actually land on pads. If they can actually make this happen and be able to recycle stuff, they think they can keep the cost down. And they're calling this basically green space launch, and it doesn't put rockets, it doesn't put the, adds any more space junk, and they're able to recycle the stuff for future lifts. Now, we'll see whether or not they can really make this happen or not, but it just goes to show you private industry is doing some pretty cool stuff in the space program. A little more information on space news. Mars, they've done some atmosphere readings, and they feel that Mars is wetter than what they really thought it was. And even though it's not very wet, they're pretty shocked by what they have found. And there's some new articles out, talks about how the moisture that's remaining on the planet circulates from the North Pole down to the South and what happens in the winter months. So scientists are having to rethink their models on how things are in Mars. Okay, a couple of more, let's see here, space articles. China basically has successfully launched what they call Tiangong 1. Tiangong 1. It is its first space lab. It's the first of a series of a small test stations and the first step towards the China's goal of having a 60-ton space station orbit by 2020. Our very first space lab that we had back in 1973 with the U.S. Skylab was 77 tons. The Soviet-era Mir was 130 tons. And the current International Space Station, I believe, is 544 tons currently. 449 tons. But what do you guys think about the Chinese and putting up their space station? You know, the U.S. has been unwilling to share rocket technology with China for obvious reasons. You know, if you give them rocket technology and how to get spacecraft or satellites into space, you also give them a huge up in nuclear, basically, delivery. And so the United States has been very leery in passing technology to China, and they've had to figure it out all on their own. The Russians have been the same. They haven't shared very much with them either, anything very specific. They have given them some help, and some of their lift capacity is provided by the Russians. But here's the thing to think about. You know, they're starting to put stuff up, and what a better way to get the Chinese to start cooperating a little more is to, you know, if they want to help out and add to the International Space Station, I think that would be something that people should look at. But, you know, everyone is still politically very wary of what the Chinese are doing in their space program. And even though they've signed on to the non-militarization of space, you know, we saw what they did a couple of years ago by blowing up that satellite, which has caused a huge space junk problem, just to say and show that they could. And, of course, the United States followed in kind. But, you know, here's the question. What do you guys think? Do you think that it's time to, you know, talk with the Chinese on this, on the space side? I remain very, you know, this is my old school thinking here on, you know, you guys know I did 24 years in the Navy. And, you know, I'm still leery of the Russians, let alone the Chinese. But, I don't know. What do you guys think? I'd love to hear you guys' feedback on this. Link will be up in the show notes. And NASA is talking about visiting an asteroid at some point within the next 20 years or so, and how they're going to harpoon it and basically dock with an asteroid. They want to send man to an asteroid. What happens sending a man to Mars? You know, screw the asteroid. Let's move on. And the spacecraft that is circling Mercury at this point is sending some very cool science back. And scientists are having to rethink many things that they've learned about Mercury. And they'll be studying this for a long time. But link will be up in the show notes. How many of you that work with a business have been given a laptop or have a laptop as your primary connection point? In CIO.com, apparently CIOs are in the mindset of killing the laptop and bringing everything mobile. They don't want to have the hassle of supporting laptops for employees. And they really want to start pushing towards having people do stuff more on mobile devices. Boy, I don't know about that. I just can't imagine being 100% mobile and not actually having a laptop. I guess if you're not doing heavy lift stuff, it's probably okay. But any of you work in IT divisions where you guys are wanting to abolish the laptop and move on and move everything mobile? I'd love to hear your feedback. Geeknews@gmail.com. Of course, you can reach me on Twitter at Geeknews, or the voicemail hotline is 619-342-7365. Hey, over on BloombergBusinessWeek.com, they are talking about building technology to basically determine if an online review is a fake. And they've done some study, and Google has contributed some money to this, Microsoft as well, a couple $100,000 to basically study the issue. And what they're seeing is that about 30% of all reviews that you find online right now have been, they're basically fake. They're not written by real, well, they're written by real people, but they're not real reviews. If right now you can hire someone to do 200 fake write-ups for about $100. You just hire someone in Bangladesh, and within days, they'll write you 200 rave reviews about your company or your business, and put it all over the web. So, you know, this is what a lot of companies are doing right now. They're buying fake reviews, and they're paying people to post stuff in mass. So be careful out there. I think we all knew that already, but it's growing. Tougher rules for UK broadband advertising. And for those of you living in the UK, basically starting in April of next year, providers will no longer be able to advertise maximum speeds for net packages unless 10% of customers can actually get that speed. This new rules come from your Committee of Advertising Practice, CAP. And so they've got some definite changes there. And they don't want data being shared that is incorrect, and I think we see that here in the United States. Just like I was told that I would have 50 megs down and 5 megs up, and you'll never get, unless you're connected to the internal network, never truly see 50 megs down. I'm more like 27 or 30. I'm not complaining compared to what I was. And believe me, I think we're good for bandwidth right now here, finally. All right, Samsung to pay Microsoft royalties for over Android. This is just, man, this is amazing. Samsung is starting to pay Microsoft royalties for every sale of its smartphone and tablet computer that run the rival Google Android platform. Microsoft has long accused Android of violating its patents, and Samsung's going to pay Microsoft over $440 million over the next year. So the question is, what is Samsung going to do? Can they afford? This seems like a lot of money. Can they afford to do that? And basically, Samsung says, we can't risk any more patent lawsuits. And of course, they got that big one going on down in Australia, and probably one here in the United States shortly as well. But and of course, the one in Germany that's already affected is down there. But I don't think Apple's going to get their way as much as they want in the case down in Australia. But $440 million for basically patent licensing. Microsoft has also cracked down on Windows Phone app spam, limits developers to 10 apps per day. I guess this was being an issue all over the place. And how are these folks putting out that many apps at once? It blows me away. Hey, Meg Whitman, the new HP CEO, has agreed to take a base salary of $1. Of course, she has she could earn as much as $2.4 million this year in bonuses if she's able to get the stock to a certain price. So she's not going to be hurting for money anytime soon. And actually, She's rich in her own right, and having run for that office in California before, non-successfully, but, you know, she's definitely not having to worry about where next meal's coming from. Twitter ad revenues are expected to be nearly $400 million by 2013. That's amazing. Their promoted tweets are going to bring them that much money. They're saying in 2011, they're going to earn $139 million, 2012, $259, and in 2013, $399.5 million. This was according to eMarketer.com. I'll have the link up in the show notes on this, but pretty big earnout by Twitter on an annual basis for money earned just for promoted ads, maybe whatever else they're going to be bringing up. How many of you have a Zune Pass? You know, you've been getting 10 free songs a month. Well, Microsoft is changing Zune Pass today. They're changing the price from $14.99 to $9.99, which is great. Cheaper is better. And, of course, the price is more in line with current offerings on the market from Radio, Moog, Rhapsody, Spotify, and so forth. But the Zune Music Pass is, with this reduction in price, you're no longer going to get 10 songs a month for free. So those this subscription will start on October 3rd. But current pass holders can keep their $14.99 subscription and keep on jamming on 10 free downloads a month. Okay. Hey, here's a kind of a cool picture, and this was over on Gizmodo, and I don't know where they lifted it from. But, you know, that earthquake that happened on the East Coast, well, they're climbing on top of the Washington Monument. They're doing a surveying of the Washington Monument to see if it's got cracks, and they're documenting what repairs are going to need to be done on the monument itself. Here's something that really doesn't surprise me. Chrome is about to knock Firefox to third place. And according to internet stats from StatCounter, Chrome has grown in use by 50% and is on track to take the silver medal by December. StatCounter is just one company among many that track this. Now, I use StatCounter for Geek News Central and looking at the stats here, and I'm seeing that trend as well. So we're going to see potentially here Chrome knocking off Firefox by the end of the year, unless Firefox is able to get their act together and really lower the overhead in which they're promising to do in this next version, which some people are saying is not as being as effective. But anyway, that probably shouldn't come as a surprise to all of you geeks out there. Hey, over on Web Designer Depot, I'm always looking for cool business cards, and they've got 15 free logos here, some different templates and stuff you can download. And so if you're looking for some cool business cards, this may be a good place to start to get the template. And link will be up in the show notes. Nothing like a cool business card, let's be honest. And every time I see a cool business card, I look at it at length and admire the design, and I'm sure many of you do the same thing. Well, a payment provider has handed over the names of a torrent site owner, and basically a Dutch peer-to-peer site has been outed by the folks that take money for them. And so anyway, this company is, you know, they couldn't get it from the hosting company. So Bren has been outed, B-R-E-I-N. Bren has that group has been outed. So we'll see how this goes. But the music and movie industry is using multiple angles to bring down sites and probably go after users as well. For those of you in the UK, OnLive was just activated. And apparently a lot of your internet service providers over there are having trouble. Some of them are filtering the traffic. They seem to think that it's peer-to-peer traffic instead of just standard net traffic. And they're trying to figure that out. Now, OnLive uses a UDP connection to transfer game data. And specifically, the network that was having the most trouble was TalkTalk's traffic shaping equipment was basically mistaking it for peer-to-peer, and they shut them down. So Vinny and you can TalkTalk, that could be an issue. Hey, if you've been a big fan of the iPod Classic or the Shuffle, it's being reported that that Apple is going to be discontinuing the iPod Classic and the Shuffle. So we'll see what develops here on this. For those of you that use Bing Search a lot, Bing today launched airport maps for 42 cities. And it shows you the concourses and how to get around and where the different gates are. So we've got Houston. Where else? What other sites do they have? Do they list them? They don't. But most of the big airports, I would assume, have been covered. But this is available over on Bing.com. Thanks for the folks over at TechCrunch for this article. I was going to spend a little more time on this particular article, but we're running out of time here on the show. But one thing I want you guys to think about is Flash. You know, Flash is maybe on the downswing. A lot of folks are making, changing their sites so they're HTML5 capable. It can support iOS devices. And people are trying to scratch their head and say, where did Flash go wrong? And, I've been on the bandwagon here that Flash was on its way out for a long time. But some other people are starting to finally kind of wake up to this. And kind of wonder what your guys' thoughts are. Do you think Flash is going to be here for the long haul? Or do you think that, like everything else, it may go the way of the dinosaur? Boom, 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 boom. Let's see here. I can skip that. How many of you search Craigslist a lot? If you want to have a quicker search for Craigslist, go to craigstant.com, craigstant.com. This is a third-party site that's basically helping you find stuff on Craigslist. So I'll put that up there in the show notes for you. If you want a sneak peek of the new Android ice cream sandwich build, I've got a good video of that, about a three-minute video that was basically popped on lifehacker.com. So I have that in the show notes for you to check out. Hey, also, make sure you've been watching Geek News Central. The writers there, all the team, have been doing great stuff. Alan wrote a great article on taking screenshots with a non-rooted Android device. Have that up in the show notes. Also, Jeffrey wrote a good article on the new Delicious website, which relaunched. And they've still got some issues. They're working on adding stuff. But they have a soft launch on the new Delicious website. If you haven't been to Delicious in a while, you may want to check that out. Alan also wrote a great article on Flickr releasing a photo session and Android app. So I have that up. It's a pretty nice app. I was looking at the video on it. And just when Flickr is, kind of on the decline, they do something to kind of reel us all back in. So I have that up for you to check out. Skype 2.4 for Android brings video calls to 14 new devices, include Honeycomb tablets. So that's on the street and available. So article will be up in the show notes for you there. T-Mobile has joined Verizon to support Samsung in Apple patent lawsuit. So this is a big one here. It looks like T-Mobile, Verizon. Now, who is AT&T going to jump on board? Doubtful. But anyway, T-Mobile has joined Verizon to support Samsung in their lawsuit. So we'll see what happens with this and what they're actually offering up. iPhone 5 is said to have HSPA plus data. China Unicom says, so this would be good. Now, we know that the iPhone 4 had WCDMA, but if it has HSPA+, that would mean that the iPhone 5 could support up to 21 megs per second connection. So this is pretty big deal if this ends up being a true statement. Hey, you remember SciStar? I thought they were already done, but apparently SciStar has lost its appeal battle with Apple. And told to ditch Mac clones forever. Now, what would your kids do if the government all of a sudden says that they are going to limit the number of SMS messages they can send in a day? Well, the Indian government has decided to crack down on SMS-based telemarketing. And as of this week, every Indian mobile user or company is allowed only to send 100 text messages per day. As part of a new anti-spam initiative, if it limited to 100, my kids would have to put them in a 12-step program. And finally tonight, extremetech.com, they've come up with a new alcohol detector, and all you got to do is put your finger on it, and they feel this may make it into cars sometime in the upcoming future. Instead of having to blow into a straw or something to get your car to start, they say now all you have to do is put your finger on a sensor and it will be able to tell how much alcohol is in your blood. So We'll see. The new system is only going to cost about $200 to include in a vehicle, which is much cheaper than the breath analyzer one. Okay, let me go ahead and look and see what we got for email comments tonight. Actually, let me go ahead and load. Let me go over and look at voicemail first and see if we've got any over there. And what time am I? I'm doing okay on time. So we'll go over to the website. And we'll log in. And how many voicemails do we have? And some, I get a lot of junk on this voicemail hotline. Oh, there's four. That's suspect. And they're all pretty short ones. So these may be just like, we'll start them and stop them. We'll see. And we'll go ahead and hit play. I should have really had these downloaded and queued. Come on, JavaScript. Where are you? Yes, there you are.
Hi, this is Scott.
Oh, Scott. Scott is trying to sell me something. So let's listen to the next one here.
Hey, Todd. This is Richard from Columbus, Georgia, calling in regards to Show 708. You mentioned that Apple was denied a trademark for multi-touch. What they were denied was a trademark for the term multi-touch.
Oh.
Not a patent or any kind of patents on the multi-touch functions, but on the term itself. Just thought I'd give you that correction. Thanks.
Hey, thank you for the correction. That's definitely appreciated, and good catch on that. All right, here comes the next one, and I think this one might be another one of those sales one. Matter of fact, I know it is. It's from the one area code. And the last one, what date was that one sent? I think that's it. So we had one actual recall and four junk ones in there. So thanks for the call on the voicemail hotline. Of course, that's available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at 619-342-7365. Let me go ahead and open up the email comments for the show. And I got an email here from Richard. He says, hey, Todd. Richard, again, just want to tell you about a podcast I saw on iTunes. Navigate to This Week in Social Media. It's a video podcast. They have a Facebook developer on the show, and he goes through and shows exactly what the new Facebook is going to be. You're not going to like it. Well, I think we've been talking about it here quite a bit, Richard, and I'm very aware of what's coming. I'm not so much against what they're launching on the profile updates, but I am very worried about what happens outside the Facebook gates and Facebook calling home to mama. So thanks for that. I got an email from Henry. He says, hello, Todd. Aloha, Todd. Why would Facebook need a political action committee? He says they want to overturn COPPA. So he's got some links here on that where Mark Zuckerberg wants kids under 13 to be able to join Facebook, and they want to be able to shut down, according to Henry here, and also an article that was on hackeducation.com, they want to shut down or actually have COPPA overturned. So thanks for that, Henry. And someone also told me, and I didn't realize this, but apparently political action committees do not have to report who they contribute to. So they can send $1 million to one candidate, $1 million to the other one in the other party, and no one's going to know who they supported. So they don't even have to report. So I guess from that perspective, they keep that genie in its bottle. I got an email here from Scarlett. She says, hey, Todd, here's a contest you may be interested in. Nissan is offering people the chance to create a virtual road trip and will select the best ones to become reality. If you win, you and three people will go on an all-expense-paid lodging, food, and gas road trip. All you have to do is go to myversaroadtrip.com and plan your own virtual road trip by selecting a point-to-point route, assign a soundtrack, and describe your trip in 104 letters or less. Partnered with Google Maps, your road trip will be turned into a fly-through film that stimulates the experience in a Nissan Versa based on these films. Nissan will choose participants to go on their customized road trips. Is this something you'd want to share with your readers? Yes, I did. And thank you, Scarlett. I've shared that. So I got an email here from Dave. He says, hey, Todd, this looks like a possible replacement for your landline. It's a Skype phone adapter for $60 a year with unlimited calling. The website does an extremely poor job of marketing it. The website does not clearly say what the device can do. It looks like a box that hooks up to your router and telephone sets. If it worked, it would be a cheap replacement for traditional landlines. He's got that for me here. It's basically on the Skype. It's at shop.skype.com. He says there are other alternatives like UMA, NetTalk, but it's not clear if the Skype telephone adapter is similar to the limited information on the Skype website. And this is from Dave. Thanks, Dave, for that. And an email here from Frankie said, hey, share your qualms about Facebook's path. I believe that Facebook has proven its actions and intentions to be untrustworthy. I tend from now on when I visit the site to do so in a private browser session. This editorial from the Chicago Trib is most interesting. So he's got that for me, and I'll have that link up in the show notes. And finally, I had an email here from Tim. He says, hey, Todd, I'm an avid Facebook user, and I used it from everything. Many would probably agree I share too much information on Facebook, from my Foursquare check-ins to my sleep patterns through an iPhone app. Despite being a generally shy person, I just like sharing, I guess, especially over my Facebook page. That said, I think Facebook has crossed a line here in privacy, and I agree with you. When I got home this evening, first thing I did was log in and attempt to cancel it. After logging into my privacy settings, I select apps, games, and websites, and finally instant personalization. Facebook is on top of this bad press because the first thing they do is bring an instant pop-up video drumming up support and correcting misunderstandings about the option, which reminds me of a new Google product video. After I quickly close it, I find that the tiny little box to unselect at the bottom called Enable Instant Personalization on Partner Websites. After unselecting this option, Facebook quickly brings up another pop-up that asks, are you sure with this to the point message? It says, recently people have been spreading false rumors about instant personalization. The program was introduced in April of 2010, and if you choose to disable it, none of your information can be shared when you or your friends arrive on those websites. By confirming, you will no longer immediately see customized content and friendly activity on partner websites. He says, after several nail-biting seconds, Facebook unselects the box and you're home free, you hope. Anyways, I think this is what you were talking about, at least on this issue. If not, correct me in the guide, the Ohana, to the correct settings. Pics attach. P.S. Reselecting the box is painless and instant. Laugh out loud. I'm constantly having problems with Chrome crashing, among other issues, just like you do on the show. To be fair, I think you're heavily loading it, and as for me, I'm using it on a mediocre laptop surfing multiple pages. Take care, Tim. And, you know, Tim, I think there's just a lot of issues there. And it goes back to, you know, Facebook. And the thing I'm worried about is basically, I don't care what I do inside Facebook. I know is in there forever. But I don't like the ability, again, of going outside of Facebook and then something calling home to mama and basically saying Todd was over at CNN.com or FoxNews.com or MSNBC and read a specific article, and it sends that back to Facebook. That's where I have a major issue. And I think you found the right stuff here. I'll be digging in a little deeper on the email, but I appreciate you sending such a detailed response back. It is greatly appreciated. And that's going to wrap it up for email tonight, folks. And that's going to bring us to the close of the show here. I want to thank everyone for basically tuning in, listening, or watching the show. If you're watching live, thanks for being a part of the family. I know a lot of folks can't stay up this late, but clocks are going to change here in the near future. You're going to be 1 hour closer to me when we do the time changeover. So I hope that'll be give some of you on the West Coast the opportunity to stay up and watch the show. But I know you guys all are catching it post-show. But again, if you're here for the very first time from Google Plus, I want to, of course, welcome you to the Ohana. And thank you for subscribing to the show. I try to bring you a lot of tech content. You know, the format of the show is pretty well laid out. First 10 or 15 minutes of the show, we just kind of talk about personal stuff and what's going on. And then I try to dedicate for you a full hour of tech content and commentary that is returned back from listeners and viewers like you. It's been my pleasure to bring you a show. We'll see you on Saturday for the Saturday Morning Tech Show at 9 a.m. Pacific, 12 noon Eastern, or right back here at Geek News Central Monday night, or for Tuesday morning podcast release available via all of the major podcasting websites, include iTunes, Zoom Marketplace, Blueberry.com, TechPodcast.com, and of course right here at GeekNewsCentral.com. Everyone take care. We'll see you next time. And aloha.